While there's enough cobalt supply for now, demand is expected to surge in the coming years as Tesla expands and the rest of the auto industry follows suit, releasing their own EVs. Warnings about long-term shortages caused cobalt prices to spike in 2017 and 18, which prompted Elon to work on reducing reliance on the metal. This recent deal with Glencore signals cobalt will remain a key to the company's expansion over the next few years, and in all likelihood, means that a Tesla cobalt-free battery is still a few years away at a minimum. It also confirms what we already know to be true, that the lithium-ion battery technology will remain the focus in the years to come, and the chemistries Tesla uses will continue to contain roughly 5-10% of cobalt in the cathodes. If there was a chance that cobalt could be eliminated anytime soon, this deal probably would not be necessary. From a purely bottom-line standpoint, Tesla securing a long-term cobalt supply deal now, while prices are depressed, is yet another shrewd move and will pay dividends in the years to come. As many have speculated, this could be another piece to the puzzle of Tesla eventually bringing battery manufacturing in-house. Glencore is an Anglo-Swiss mining giant and the largest industrial supplier of cobalt in the world. They're expected to provide Tesla with up to 6,000 tons of cobalt per year under this new long-term partnership. The financials of the deal were not disclosed, but one ton of cobalt is worth around $30,000. To put the size of the deal into context, SK Innovation signed a deal for up to 30,000 tons of cobalt over 6 years, or 5,000 tons per year, and Samsung SDI's deal was for up to 21,000 tons over 5 years, or 4,000 tons per year. Tesla will most likely make the cobalt available for its battery partners Panasonic, LG Chem, and others. Manufacturers often use their leverage to secure elements for suppliers, so while Tesla will almost certainly produce batteries in-house, this deal by no means signals that's happening imminently. The cobalt from Glencore will come from the DRC, which is where Glencore has been operating a copper mine in the Katanga region since 2008. The DRC supplies more than two-thirds of the world's cobalt, and human rights groups have raised concerns that the industry relies on child slave labor. Tesla did touch on their sourcing of cobalt in their recent impact report. Here are the excerpts to note. Quote, because Tesla recognizes the higher risks of human rights issues within cobalt supply chains, particularly for child labor in the DRC, we have made a significant effort to establish processes to remove these risks from our supply chain. We also recognize that mining conducted in a responsible and ethical manner is an important part of the economic and social well-being of those communities. We review all information provided by our suppliers for red flags and risks associated with ethical sourcing. Where we can be assured that minerals, including cobalt, are coming from mines that meet our social and environmental standards, we will continue to support sourcing from the DRC and other regions. Tesla's batteries use nickel-rich cathode materials, which contain less cobalt than other widely used cathode chemistries in the industry, with our ultimate goal being to eliminate cobalt completely from our cells. For portions of our battery cell sourcing, we procure cobalt materials directly from producers that are verified as compliant with Tesla's code. We work with participants along the value chain to shorten the supply chain by eliminating third-party cobalt refiners and by ensuring that Tesla's material is stored in clearly marked and segregated areas of the plant and is toll processed on dedicated lines for Tesla's production. For other parts of our supply chain where Tesla does not directly procure cobalt materials, cobalt may be sourced from many different countries, including the DRC. For material originating from the DRC, Tesla's battery cell supplier and sub-suppliers are required to purchase refined cobalt material exclusively from qualified conformant cobalt refiners as per the Responsible Minerals Assurance Process standards set forth by the Responsible Minerals Initiative, or RMI. End quote. Of course, that's corporate for we know what's going on in the DRC, but we're going to continue to source it from there, so we'd like to protect ourselves with this boilerplate Responsible Minerals Initiative. This brings us to Glencore and the truth about who they are. A special investigative report by Industrial, a global union representing 50 million workers in 140 countries in the mining, energy, and manufacturing sector, highlighted the dark side of that which is operations at Glencore. When Industrial visited the DRC in 2018 to meet with local unions at Glencore Mines, the company denied access to its operations, and security forces attempted to break up a union meeting at a church to arrest the organizers. In 2019, the Paradise Papers revealed that Glencore paid huge sums of money to a corrupt fixer in order to obtain mining interests in the DRC. Glencore directly employs 84,000 people around the world, with a total of 146,000, including contractors. A big reason why Glencore has gotten away with so much is their corporate structure. They're actually a hybrid, as they have built up an incredibly complex network of more than 80 subsidiaries on 5 continents, using shell corporations, partnerships, and offshore accounts to obscure transactions and to avoid taxes, working with corrupt intermediaries to gain access to resources. Glencore's founder was on the FBI's most wanted list for almost 20 years. This, of course, led to the company keeping a low profile, but since the company's IPO in 2011, the leaks of the Panama Papers, Paradise Papers, and Hillary Clinton emails, more information about the true corporate behavior has come to light. Glencore, originally named Mark Rich & Co., was founded in 1974 by Mark Rich, a commodities trader. Rich would fly into conflict zones with borrowed money, making deals with the oil industry officials to buy oil directly, bypassing established companies like BP and Exxon. The company's fortune was built on tax avoidance. In 1983, Rich was charged in the US with tax evasion, fraud, and illegal business dealings, which is when he fled to Switzerland. Rich was controversially pardoned by Bill Clinton on his last day in office in 2001, and Glencore's headquarters remain in Canton Zug in Switzerland, where it's one of the largest companies. Getting back to Cobalt and Tesla, this is perhaps the starkest example of Glencore's treatment of its workforce in the DRC. Already a lawless country, the DRC is central to Glencore's fortune, and much of their success is dependent on operations there. According to the leaked Paradise Papers, Glencore loaned $45 million to controversial Israeli billionaire Dan Gertler, which was essentially a bribe to save Glencore $440 million. Later, Glencore paid him another $960 million to buy his stake in the mines. Gertler is linked to a string of bribery allegations and is subject to criminal proceedings. The US Treasury sanctioned Gertler in December 2017, saying his corruption had cost the DRC $1.3 billion. Glencore employs about 15,000 people in DRC through its subsidiaries Mutanda Mining and Katanga Mining. It intends to double cobalt production over the next few years. 7 workers died at Katanga in 2016 when the wall of an open pit mine collapsed, and missions by human rights activists have exposed terrible working conditions where workers say they're treated like slaves, regularly being exposed to dangerous conditions. The poverty of the region is clear to see, despite cobalt being hugely valuable to the tech world. However, almost all of this wealth disappears into foreign companies, or locally through corruption with the complicity of foreign companies. Glenn Mpufain, director at Industrial, said, quote, "We were shocked by the desperate poverty of the people of Kolwezi and the lack of development and infrastructure. The contrast with Glencore's vast wealth is stark. There is a great irony in the fact that environmentally conscious electric car buyers rely on a supply chain built on Glencore's environmental and social pillaging," end quote. Mark Dummett, head of business and human rights at Amnesty International, said, quote, "When we first went into mines in 2015, we saw how men, women, and children were working without even the most basic protective equipment, such as gloves and face masks. And miners told us about health conditions they experienced, including coughing, pain in their lungs, and UTIs. In one village we visited, people showed us how the water in the local stream that they drank from was contaminated by the discharge of waste from a mineral processing plant," end quote. While Glencore is in a prime position to benefit from a boom in EV sales, it has so far struggled to make that happen. The company booked losses last year related to cobalt after prices collapsed in mid-2018 from too much supply. In November, it shut one of its cobalt mines in the DRC for a maintenance program that is still ongoing. After customers reneged on contracts in response to the price slump, Glencore spent most of last year locking in new long-term deals throughout the EV supply chain. Direct deals with miners are rare in the auto sector, and the agreements between Glencore, Tesla, BMW, and others signal carmakers are concerned about securing sufficient supply. It's estimated that at least 20% of the DRC cobalt output is produced at informal, makeshift mines where fatalities and human rights abuses are commonplace. This number is most likely even higher, as any outside source is typically not allowed any access to the true operations. Tesla said it will support sourcing of the metal from the DRC if it can be assured raw materials are coming from operations that meet social and environmental standards. But once again, this feels like a situation where we're all going to turn a blind eye to what's really going on. What do you guys think? Is Tesla really going out of its way to make sure that the cobalt they buy is sourced ethically? Are any of these sources in the DRC actually being run ethically? Should Tesla stop sourcing cobalt and find another way? Or is the long-term mission more important? I'd love to hear what you guys think, as it's easy for me to make arguments both ways. Please consider becoming a producer on Patreon if you'd like to support the channel. If not, all likes, comments, and time you spend watching videos help me to continue to produce content. I'll see you guys in the next one.